What is the biggest challenge for the Italian presidency during the next 6 months, in your opinion?
The Italian presidency falls in a very sensitive period for the European Union. We just had the elections for the European Parliament. We are now in the process of forming the new Commission. So the next few months will be very important from the institutional point of view, because it will have to be reshaped, the Union. Beside this institutional aspect, which is extremely important, the result of the European Parliament elections has shown that there is a growing disconcert, a growing sense of discomfort with between the public opinion of the member states and the institutions. So another big challenge is how to realign the institutions in tune with the feeling of the majority of the people. We are pleased that in Italy, for example, there was a big success of the party ruling the government coalition now, which shows that there is a strong pro-European movement. There were, however, members of the parliament that were elected from the anti-Europe milieu. In other countries, this phenomenon was much stronger. Romania is interesting from this point of view, because Romania is probably the only country in Europe where you don't have any member of the parliament, either at European Parliament level or at the national level, which is openly anti-system. So being ambassador of Italy to Romania in this moment is quite instructive, because you can see that there is this exception, a positive exception. So this is another priority. The biggest challenge, however, is the economy. Europe is still in a financial crisis, but there is the biggest challenge is the unemployment. We have more than 26 million people, especially young people, unemployed. And we need to find ways to stimulate growth and to give access to the work to young people.
Do you have any explanation about the low representation of anti-European, Eurosceptic parties in Romania, but also in Italy?
Well, Romania is still a country which is has, in the public opinion, a positive approach vis-à-vis Europe. Romania is still in the process of seeing all the potential benefits from the European Union. While countries that were founding members of the Union, France, Italy, those older countries are, yes, UK came later and it was not a founding member, but also in the UK there was this movement. Those bigger countries that have a longer experience have some sort of skepticism. So that's why I say that we should probably learn from the enthusiasm of countries like Romania in order to reactivate a little bit the feeling in our countries as well.
What are the main events planned during the Italian presidency in Romania?
Of course. Thank you for asking this question. The Embassy of Italy, together with the Cultural Institute, together with the other actors of what we call the Sistema Italia, the Italian Chamber of Commerce, the Association of Industrialists, is working to create a series of events during the presidency to highlight our activities. So besides the institutional events, the usual meetings with ministers, members of the government, of the ambassadors of the 28 countries, we will have a series of initiatives open to the public in order to stimulate some interest. Some already took place. On the 2nd of July, we had the inauguration of the presidency with a beautiful concert at Ateneo, with an Italian conductor and maestro Gianluigi Zampieri, and an Italian a program of Italian music. And during that occasion, we gave a special Medal of Merit from the Italian President of the Republic to the famous violin player Alexandru Tomescu, who plays the only Stradivari present in Romania. And that was a big event. It was broadcast live by the radio. We want to involve as much as possible Romanian, Romanian artists and Romanian actors in our activities. We don't want to have simply Italian activities as such. Coming to music, we will have on the 1st of October another beautiful concert by one of the most famous violin players in the world, Maestro Uto Ughi from Italy. The 1st of October marks International Music Day, so it's a homage that we want to give to this special form of art. Always in the field of concerts, we will have Baroque music with trumpet and organ players in Bucharest and other cities in Romania in the course of the fall. And we will have a famous Italian jazz player, trumpet player, one of the most famous worldwide, Paolo Fresu, coming with some of his colleagues and performing on the 14th of October a beautiful concert. We'll also have a program of contemporary dance with a group called the Mediterranea. And we are also planning to have a series of events on economic aspects. We want to organize seminar conferences. One already took place on the 8th of July. We had organized together with Confindustria, the Association of Italian Industrialists, a seminar on the issue of the use of European funds. As you know, this is a big priority for Romania. And we wanted to take this opportunity to highlight the good practices done by the Romanian government to improve the situation in absorbing funds. Minister Teodorovic opened the seminar, and I think it was a very good moment of exchange of views between diplomats, government members, and the private sector. We'll also organize in October, at the end of October, together with the Italian Chamber of Commerce in Romania, a seminar on agriculture. Agriculture has a rich potential in Romania. It's one of the most advanced countries in terms of potentiality in Europe, as you know. There are many, many Italian investors that are looking at this particular sector. So we want to look at future possibilities of improving even more, getting even more from this sector in the field of agriculture. So as you can see, there are several events, both artistic and economic.
Now, about a few things about the Italian presidency priorities. As they are mentioned briefly on the official website, I can read the growth and employment, a space for freedom and security, full exercise of citizenship rights, and the stronger role of Europe in the world. Mm-hmm. For the first of them, growth and employment, do you think it will be possible for Italy and other countries to make structural reforms in order to achieve growth and employment within the limits imposed by the stability and growth pact?
Yes, we're working on that. It's an ambitious program in order to improve the conditions, especially for the youth. Probably there will be no time during the semester to make structural reforms, but what we need to do is to introduce some forms of flexibility, especially when it comes to young people. This is very important because there must be a certain degree of flexibility in the rules. In terms of the public investments and the public management of funds. This is extremely important. I would like to mention that the new system of the European Union is not only the presidency, but it is the trio system, the following three presidencies, which gives an advantage because you have some priorities that can be pursued in a 18 months period and not only in 6 months, which is at times a little bit short. So the Italian presidency is already working with the following two presidencies, Lithuania and Luxembourg, in order to ensure that on this specific field something will be done. Another major issue is the necessity to reassure, to reinforce the fact that Europe is a space of freedom and there must be full application of civil rights for all the citizens. And Italy is in the forefront of this particular issue. I would like to mention that Europe is an open space where we have free circulation of people. We are facing, Europe is facing a big problem now, and the problem is going to be bigger in the future, of pressure on the borders by immigrants from third countries. As you know, Italy is in the front line with the Mediterranean, but also the eastern part of Europe, and Romania has the longest border with non-European countries in the EU. This is a situation that we should challenge, and we should make sure that, first of all, we are able to control the influx of those immigrants. So that's why Italy is in favor of creating a coordination of the coast guards, the border police, and also once the immigrants are in Europe, their fundamental rights must be preserved and achieved. Another important issue is the right of minorities in Europe, which makes the richness of the continent. So we are working in consultation with the following presidency about those issues.
And also about enlargement, it was mentioned among the priorities that the accession negotiations with the Western Balkans will be encouraged and will work to give new impetus to the negotiations with Turkey. On the other hand, recently, the new European Commission President, Mr. Jean-Claude Juncker, said that no enlargement will be possible in the next 5 years. Mm-hmm. So, what is Italy? What is Italy's position?
Traditionally, Italy is in favor of enlargement, and enlargement is a goal, which is a strategic goal, in order to make the continent stronger and more stable. But being strategic, it has needs planning, and it's a process. It's difficult to say to give a time frame for a session. It's a process. Those countries have to meet the criteria, and there can be a stronger integration of those countries even without formal accession, but through other instruments. Let's take the recent case, for example, of the agreements between the Union and Georgia, Moldavia, and Ukraine. This is extremely important because already those markets can have access to the European Union, the populations can move more freely with less restrictions. So this goes, let's say, parallel to the enlargement, but it's a program that at the end of the day creates the positive path towards the final goal. So Italy will continue, as it did always in the past, to support enlargement when the time is ripe for achieving this goal.
Now, about the frontline subject these days, the negotiations for the next European Commission. Mm-hmm. How do you see this process, the portfolios discussed? Maybe the portfolio is interesting for Italy, but also for Romania, who expressed the interest for agriculture portfolio. Mm-hmm. Would it be possible to keep the portfolios? What's the country?
Well, definitely Italy, given the fact that the ruling coalition has had big success with more than 40% of the votes at the European Parliament is, and given the fact that Italy is one of the biggest, strongest countries and one of the founding members, would like to have important portfolios, of course. Negotiation is still going on. It's very delicate. It's done by the central government, so I'm not in a position to give comments on that. But obviously, Italy aspires at having a an important portfolio. As far as the Romanian candidate is concerned, this falls within this negotiation, which is quite complex, as we've seen. The Romanian commissioner is well known for his competence. He has been, over the years, well appreciated by everybody. So he is a strong candidate, of course, for keeping that portfolio, which is very important for Romania. And as I mentioned, agriculture is an important sector for the Romanian economy. So I personally believe that could be a good solution.
Okay,
thank you.